Why, look at Jessica.
Boy, are you hip.
Oh, hip.
Jessica, you're
Jessica, look at Grandpa.
The year 2000 hip, hip girl. What can you sing? Sing a song for us, please.
Sing a song. Sing out loud.
Sing a song. Da 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 da. Jessica, kiss goodbye. Wave bye bye. Steve, so long. Bye.
Okay. Yeah, bye.
Bye, Steve.
Close that door.
Say goodbye to your son. That's the camera.
Kiss goodbye. Dear father.
We have to get the train. Hi. Come on, we got 5 minutes to get the train. We don't even have tickets. The tickets. Hurry up, we have 5 minutes to get to the station.
I know who you're talking about, but at least you're
over.
Good Shabbos. Good Shabbos.
Took an effort to try to find out if the Pentagon was still sticking to the Wonder Woman story. So I generated a series of letters through my senators and my congressmen, and I also urged other researchers to do the same thing. What we got was a very clear pattern of denial and buck passing.
The people of New Mexico were also alerting their own congressman, Stephen Schiff, who took up the case on their behalf.
From the statements of witnesses that I've seen or read, a number of individuals described that whatever it was that was recovered from the area around actually Corona, New Mexico, near Roswell, that it, apparently it was put in a special plane that was flown in for this purpose, and that the materials were under armed guards because people described the MPs. And I think it's logical to say that weather balloons aren't normally flown by special planes under armed guard. So that by itself at least raises a legitimate question as to, was this a weather balloon? I got a response from an Air Force colonel who just said, we referred your request to the National Archives. You know, that simple, that quick. And so I contacted the Department of Defense again and received a response at a higher level. We're referring you to the National Archives. So I contacted the National Archives. The National Archives responded to me that they didn't have any material on the Roswell incident. Now, needless to say, I considered this a runaround at the least, and it was at that point that I asked our General Accounting Office to assist me.
Coming up next on Travel Channel Presents, at 10, uncover the evidence supporting stories of close encounters from around the world. Travel Channel Presents continues next on the Travel Channel.
Cover up with information concerning the Roswell events. An investigator was assigned to the case, reporting back, of course, to the Congressman's office, since the General Accounting Office is a creature of the Congress. It's the Congress's investigative arm. This investigator approached an official within the Air Force Congressional Liaison Office, the Director of Plans and Operations, Colonel Larry Shockley. The investigator said to Colonel Shockley, I'm interested in getting into the Roswell case. Colonel Shockley's response reportedly was, you've got no business getting into that. This is not the first, and I suspect nor will it be the last, such obstruction of this investigation.
They didn't say, Congressman Schiff, we have documents, but they're classified. You're going to have to go through certain procedures if you want access to them. That would have at least been a reasonable response. But to send me to an agency which doesn't have the documents, and by now they must know that, that is not a reasonable response.
Stephen Aftergood of the Federation of American Scientists believed there could be a less secretive and more mundane explanation.
The National Archives reports that it has more than 300 million pages of classified documents from before 1960 alone that are awaiting declassification review. In other words, documents dating from pre-World War I through 1960. If we extrapolate that to a likely estimate for all classified documents through the present, I would say there have to be well in excess of a billion pages of classified documents that are waiting for declassification review. A quantity of government documents that have been kept secret more than 45 years after the event. I think government accounting is long overdue, and people have every right to demand that such an accounting be carried out.
Now what we need to do is we need to establish in the United States and elsewhere around the world, that there is indeed a cover-up of information. For what reason? We can only speculate. To what end? We have the faintest idea. But the fact of the matter is that our government is not being responsive to its citizens who want simply to know the facts.
I think there's a big leap
made
by some people from an unexplained incident extraterrestrial entities that are somehow active on Earth. I am not personally cognizant of any evidence to support that, but certainly there is a vast quantity of government documentation on the phenomenon of unidentified flying objects of one sort or another.
The obsession with secrecy is a legacy of the Cold War. As West meets East, will we join the Russians in attempting to find an answer to the mystery of the UFO phenomenon?
Интересуется тем, что происходит на нашей.
We cannot rule out the possibility that creatures who may not be superior to us are interested in what is happening on our Earth. These unidentified flying objects that appear to display unique characteristics, such as their speed, their rapid maneuvering, and so on, must be studied in the interest of mankind.
I do not subscribe to the views that some ufologists hold that this is all in the mind. I believe that there is undoubtedly something, or a number of things, there may be quite different things too, in our atmosphere, which is physical, and were it to land, could be seen and touched and photographed. And indeed, there are people who say that all those things have already happened.
I hope that someday we find out what it's all about. But everybody loves a mystery. And I think someday we'll know.
It's not bright, isn't it? And then
it's changing shape. It's sort of flashing out.
Yeah, I've noticed that. It's a little really bright, isn't it? And then it's gone behind a cap.
Oh no, it's sort of flashing on the video, like the tape's running out or something.
Oh wow, it's just shot up in the air. Oh wow. Yeah, I'll tell you.
Hi, I'm Tracy Gow.
The film was minutely scrutinized by the U.S. Navy's Photographic Interpretation Lab. They concluded that the objects were not birds or balloons, but self-luminous, unidentified flying objects. Between 1948 and 1969, the U.S. Air Force investigated 12,618 reported sightings. Over 11,000 were identified as material objects, weather conditions, or hoaxes. But 700 cases remained unexplained. And every day, around the world, more sightings have been reported. For a believer like Charles Bowen, editor of Flying Saucer Review, the debate is not so much about whether UFOs are real, but rather where they come from.
You don't think it's possible that they could come from another planet within our solar system?
It is possible, but things seem to prove point otherwise.
This means they come a very long way.
Indeed.
You think this is still quite possible? This is several light years, isn't it, from the nearest?
Well, we must get round to the way of thinking in terms of non-man-made machines, something more sophisticated than we have ever produced.
Are there UFOs based here on Earth?
South America seems to be the most active area for flying saucers. Ufologists believe the spacemen may even have bases there in the Mato Grosso and the Andes, and even underwater along the Atlantic coast of Patagonia. In France, an investigator discovered that reported sightings for one September night in 1963 fell in an absolutely straight line from Bayonne to Vichy. Ufologists have since used that method to work out two lines of orbit which, they reckon, link the areas of maximum flying saucer activity.
Gordon Crichton from the British Foreign Office has his own UFO theories.
I think that there is more than one type visiting us. I think there are at least five. I'm talking types of beings, not types of craft, but about 30 types of craft. I think a minimum of five types of beings are coming, possibly eight. And I think that some of them may be friendly and some are not.
There have been many actual shapes. The cigar shape, which are usually the parent craft. There have been disc-shaped, many disc-shaped, tadpole, heel, black man shoe, bubble, triangular, and so on.
The most disturbing theory of all is that the men in the flying saucers are our own descendants, perhaps centuries in the future, who found a way of breaking through the time barrier to visit their own past, which is our present.
It is part of modern astronomy, isn't it? It's accepted by modern astronomers that it's possible that there are many planets in our galaxy that could sustain our kind of life, or life similar to ours.
Oh yes, in our galaxy, but not in the solar system. This makes an enormous difference about the travel time. If the thing is many thousand light years away from the Earth, or many million light years away from the Earth, even if you move with the speed of light, you've got to be many million years old to get here.
Whatever the reality and the possible source of the UFOs, the United States military faced growing criticism from the public and the media for not taking the subject seriously. In 1966, the U.S. Air Force asked the University of Colorado to conduct the most exhaustive scientific study of UFOs ever undertaken. Their aim was to put an end to speculation and clear the air of flying saucers once and for all. Author and UFO expert Timothy Good has closely studied the Air Force report.
If you actually read the scientific study, which is a very, very long book, it's quite clear that a relatively large percentage of the cases investigated by specialists, by scientists in specific disciplines, were unexplainable. I think something like 30% of the 117 cases examined by the Colorado University Commission were unexplainable.
Publicly, the report satisfied the military, but did little to dissuade the UFO enthusiasts. UFOs continue to surface around the world, no more so than over the small English town of Warminster. During the 60s, it became the UFO capital of the world and the focus of world attention.
One night back in the summer, it couldn't be 11th of August. I heard a sound that was really horrible. What I would have said was a communal garden helicopter.
To the explanation of these phenomena, it might be able to assure these people who have nothing to be alarmed about.
The meeting was riotous. We couldn't get into the town hall. The main street was festooned with people. Personally, I'd have a police escort to get in.
How many people here tonight are afraid of the thing? How many of you?
Was this the thing? It was photographed over Warminster by a local boy, Gordon Faulkner.
From what he told me at the time, he was coming out from his house to take his camera, which was a rather nice one, a Japanese one, that time. Much better than the one my daughter had, and he was bringing it down to loan it to her, and he was just coming out of the garden door, and he looked up and saw this thing across the skyline above the houses, and he thought, that's something odd, and he had to hold his camera, so he just snapped it. Didn't really think any more about it, thought, well, it was odd, but when it was developed, of course, that was the photograph that was sort of accepted all the way around.
The events that so terrified the inhabitants of Warminster sparked the imagination of John Spencer, then only 11 years old. Now, vice president of the British UFO Research Association, he is still intrigued by the Warminster sightings.
In terms of flying saucer pictures, it's about as good as they come, which is to say pretty bad. There's a general rule in flying saucers that the less clear pictures, usually eventually you can find the strings, rather than up, the real ones do tend to be sort of free-grain. You can find their nature, these things are reported as moving at high speed and often soundless, you're often surprised. So, you know, Gordon's account is pretty well a standard one, and the picture is not surprisingly very good. I have to say it's a very limiting picture, because there's nothing else in the picture at all to give it perspective or size or distance, you know, almost every dimension.
sensors, the world's UFO enthusiasts flocked to Warminster. Every night, sky watchers crowded the hillsides, determined to catch a glimpse of an extraterrestrial.
I remember the UFO flap down in Warminster. Back in late 1964, I think it started, and it went on through 1965 through 1967. At the height of it, I went down there, and I can remember traipsing around very cold hilltops together with teams of other enthusiasts. I never saw anything other than satellites and aircraft, I have to say, even though others disagreed with me.
30 years after this photo appeared, John Spencer had a call from Roger Houghton, a friend of Gordon Faulkner, claiming the photo was a fake.
Faulkner and I did an experiment with little models made out of old tops and buttons and sort of cotton wool. I can't remember exactly what they were, but they were all small. They were tried, flying in the air.
According to Roger, Gordon and he, and others involved, indeed the four people working here in the Warminster film at the time, got together to play a practical joke on the then owner, Charlie Nicks. Roger makes the point that considering the fuss that had been going on in Warminster, he believes that Charlie Mills knew this was a joke, because here it is, it's a tiny little paragraph here, and it's right next to, this is May Butler, with advertising for someone to take over the job of County Wildfowl on sheer water within the month. In other words, there's been no fuss made about it, considering the apparent value of this, and considering the extraordinary spread that came in Daily Mirror when Bob Shuffle was in Daily Mirror within the next day or so.
Gordon has always said that it was a genuine photograph, and I've never sort of disbelieved him, because he's a very keen photographer, does a great deal of photography, but I have never doubted him for one moment that he took a genuine photograph of something that was very odd at the time.
If I, or anyone, can prove that Gordon Faulkner is telling the truth or lying, or that Roger is telling the truth or lying, it won't make any difference to the impact this photograph has. Whether it was milk tops and buttons, or whether it was genuine UFO, the picture centered attention on Warminster.
Over the years, the case for flying saucers has been dogged by hoaxes. This craft was seen by hundreds of witnesses who were convinced it was real. In reality, the saucer was just an elaborate April Fool's joke to publicize an airline. It showed, however, just how easy it is to fool a willing public into believing they have had a close encounter. This program is sponsored at the Go. Travel Channel for... Photos and fleeting sightings can easily be explained to use. An amateur cameraman captured on film this shiny object flying up from the corn. Could this be an extraterrestrial connection to the crop circles? Attention switched to Florida and the town of Gulf Breeze.
Over those dunes, right there. Over the dunes. Oh my God. There she is. There she is, right there. Oh my God.
In 1987, this small coastal town in America was was overtaken by UFO fever. Like Warminster, the UFO sightings put Gulf Breeze firmly on the map. Ed Walters took this video in 1993 while walking along the Pensacola shoreline.
Oh my God, just up right there.
But Walters is best known for taking these spectacular pictures, proof to many people that flying saucers are real. Just a few months later, Ed Walters took this video footage from his back garden. It appears to show three similar objects maneuvering behind the trees. And in 1991, in Gulf Breeze, Ann and Bruce Morrison captured these extraordinary images on film. Curiously, or perhaps not, many UFO sightings seem to take place near military installations. Both Warminster and Gulf Breeze are next door to military bases. One of the best documented sightings occurred over the U.S. Air Force Base in Suffolk, England in 1980. Guards reported seeing a strange object in the forest. A patrol was sent out. The following extracts are taken from the actual recording made at the time. By Deputy Base Commander Colonel Charles Hawk, who sent an official memo to the Ministry of Defense about the incident. He received no explanation. Coming up, has the U.S. space program already encountered UFOs? Tomorrow. To intercept the unidentified intruder captured on radar. Closing on their target, the pilots locked onto the object. Then, something astonishing happened. Within a split second, it accelerated from 175 miles an hour to over 1,100. And dropped more than 600 yards in altitude. The force created by such a maneuver would be four times greater than the human body can withstand. Unable to match the speed of the UFO, the two F-16s returned to base. But this was not an isolated incident. Since the 1940s, over 3,500 pilots have reported seeing UFOs. It nearly cost one his job. Now retired, former BA Captain Graham Shepherd can finally talk openly about his UFO experiences.
On the 22nd of March, 1967, we returning from Gibraltar to London. Quite suddenly, we were aware that ahead of us was a star which was at least twice as bright as the best of Sirius or Venus all the while it was changing colour. It was very, very bright, iridescent colours. There were greens and blues, beautiful reds. And suddenly, everything else, it started aerobatting. It was moving around the sky, doing figures of eight, it was doing loops. It was moving at a rate which is impossible, in my view, for known aerodynamic laws. And we asked Auto Radar if they had any unidentified traffic, and they did confirm they had unidentified traffic 10 miles to the west of us.
Pilots, better than anybody else, know there is often a rational explanation for phenomena they see in the skies.
You see a number of things from the flight deck. Other aeroplanes, you see reflections from the ground. This is day and night time. Cloud formations, the effects of sunlight on cloud, ice crystals. At higher levels, it's quite common to see satellites. Visibility is excellent. It's a very wide angle of view, laterally and vertically. We run a very objective, continuous check, if you like, of things that appear outside the airplane. And in doing so for thousands and thousands of hours, one builds up quite a bank of experience.
Graham's second sighting was even more dramatic.
We were on a routine daylight flight back from Scotland to London, Heathrow, in a Vanguard, cruising at about 24,000 feet. We just transferred from the Scottish controller to the Preston radar controller, made our normal routine radio calls, and within minutes, the Preston radar controller alerted us. He told us we have opposite direction traffic in the airway, very fast moving, unknown. Immediately, of course, we looked out and the flight deck straight ahead of us to a 12-o'clock position. And into view came a disc-shaped craft. It was shaped like a discus, shining in the sun. A more accurate description would be like a hubcap for the American car. Cupola on the top, diameter about 30 feet in my view. I was looking down on the craft and machines that came past, flying very, very high speed. It came to within about a quarter of a mile of us. I was looking down on it, some 200 to 300 feet below us. Two very curious things. First of all, there was no shockwave from this machine. It was close enough, in my experience, it was close enough to give us quite a bump, a noise and a bang as the shockwave passed us. Secondly, we made no attempt to report an air miss, a near collision, or file an SOT report. So that not only us as a crew, but the Preston radar controller, we're aware that its strangeness didn't qualify for an MS or SAT report. 25 years on, I feel I've got a long, happy career behind me. And I feel so strongly that the whole subject is, and should be, in the public domain. So I've broke ranks, and decided to talk about it openly to the media. And British Airways were apoplectic. It's the only word I can use. They gave me lengthy interviews, and they followed up the interviews with a letter which, in all fairness, does describe the conflict that does exist between a subject, UFOs, which is on the fringe of believability, and the credibility of British Airways captains. British Airways wants the least possible controversy. They don't want wacky captains, they don't want wacky crews, they don't want any of the aircrew involved with any subjects which have the slightest possibility of compromise.
Given the growing number of UFO sightings and the footage captured on video, believers have accused politicians and the military of a cover-up.
How much do you think governments have suppressed what they have seen, or what organs like the Air Forces have seen?
It is something that I can't quite frankly prove.
You think that the authorities really are suppressing the information?
Not suppressing, yes, suppressing, that's true. And not allowing their junior officials to know until they can't go either.
Just 30 years, we have already landed men on the moon and sent probes to other planets. Are we really the only intelligent life out there? A number of astronauts in both the former Soviet Union and the United States are rumored to have encountered UFOs.
Armstrong is reported to have seen a UFO, or two UFOs on the moon, together with Buzz Aldrin. And a number of people from NASA have come forward with that story, including Maurice Chatelet, who's a communications specialist who helped design the Apollo spacecraft. He confirms that both Armstrong and Aldrin did indeed see UFOs on the moon. I'm not a conspiracy freak as such, but the fact of the matter is that there is an officially acknowledged cover-up of the UFO phenomenon, certainly by the United States authorities. This is easily provable because since the 1970s, thousands of documents on UFOs have now been released by the intelligence community. I'm talking not just about the FBI and the CIA, with which we're all familiar, but the Defense Intelligence Agency, the National Security Agency, the State Department Bureau of Research, the Atomic Energy Commission, Army, Air Force, Naval Intelligence, and several others, all of whom, with the exception of the Air Force, denied any serious involvement in UFOs and denied having any documents. But thanks to the Freedom of Information Act, we know they've been lying. The object that I saw in the sky here in southeast London in 1980 first appeared as a bright point of light, just like Venus or a very bright star. And at first I thought maybe this was an aircraft reflecting the last rays of the sun, because this was about 4:07 in the afternoon. But then I realized that it wasn't really in the right position for Venus or any other planet. It was much too bright to be a star. Somebody got videotape of it from the Seven Oaks area, and this is, I think, a 35 to 40 minute video, and that clearly shows a point of light in the sky. Unfortunately, you know, without a powerful zoom, you don't get any idea of the shape of it.
I mean, that could not be a weather balloon. That's impossible, because it wouldn't go up and down like that.
Many other people reported sighting a similar object. Some of the clearest and most frequent sightings in modern times have happened in Elmwood, Wisconsin. They had so many close encounters that the town became the inspiration for Steven Spielberg's famous film.
When the sun goes down over Elmwood, Wisconsin, the people of this tiny town see them.
I could see the little legs on it, like little pods on the bottom.
It was a saucer-shaped deal.
Plane got over the village, and it was gone out of sight.
Almost everyone in this community of over 900 people has seen a UFO.
I call it the Forbidden Village in the Forsaken Valley.
decided to beat the UFOs to the punch.
In my opinion, this is where they represent man's grand attempt here to reach out and establish a relationship with his society.
They are trying to raise $60 million to build a landing base and entice aliens out of their spacecraft. But some people claim aliens have already made the first move.
I was here in East Room in our bedroom, and it was 3:17 a.m. Nobody asked me. I was here alone. My husband had gone away on a training course. I was sleeping on that side of the bed, and my young son was sleeping on the side. It was a lot smaller. And I was woken up. It was just a strange feeling, really. It was like unseen hands were shaking awake. And I had this urge to get out of bed and go and look out the window. It was like someone was telling me to go and look out the window. It was very strange. I did. I got out of the bed and I walked over to those windows and looked out. In the distance, there were lots of little lights moving around. And I thought at first that there were just stars moving around in the distance. I remember thinking, wow, they look pretty. And then realizing that stars don't do that.
If you like your work, star to our planet is 25 trillion miles away. Even if we had the technology to get there, none of us would live long enough to survive the journey. In the 1960s, NASA established SETI, the Search for Extraterrestrial Intelligence, using satellite dishes to scan the airwaves. But so far, there has been no confirmed contact. In 1977, NASA launched the Voyager space probes on a mission to travel into the unknown, into deep space. On board, they carry a message from the human race. In years to come, these probes could become mysterious UFOs themselves, circling far distant planets, like the ones recently discovered by our most powerful telescopes. If anyone's out there, how will they react to the idea that we Earthlings are exploring their world, investigating them? If they find us in the heavens, will they see us as friend or foe?
In Roswell, there were many witnesses to a strange light in the sky.
But it was just
going in a northly motion at a pretty rapid speed, but it doesn't mark a falling star or a meteorite. So if I thought that he couldn't look direct at it very long at a time, then you had to look to the side of it. It was like looking into a bright sun.
William Woody is 61, a pig farmer who works for the local bus company in Roswell. He remembers to this day what he saw in the evening of July 4th, 1947.
I was 13 years alive, and that was the first time I'd ever seen anything like that. We got in the old truck one morning and headed north out 285 to see if we could locate it. Every exit or path off of the highway was blocked off with the military sentries. And said that that was under investigation and nobody was allowed to go either east or west off the highway.
On the Foster Ranch, 75 miles northwest of Roswell, Matt Brazel, a farmhand, was working when he came across some strange materials scattered in the fields. His sheep refused to go near it. Unable to identify what it was, Brazel traveled 20 miles to show his nearest neighbor what he had found. Loretta Proctor is 83 and still lives on the same ranch near Corona, north of Roswell. She remembers Brazel arriving on horseback with a collection of strange material.
He showed us this piece that looked like plastic or wood of some kind, and he said that there was some metallic looking stuff that when you crushed it, it just straightened right back out. It wouldn't, you know, wouldn't stay crushed. And there was some beans or something that he said had kind of pinkish purple printing on it. Well, we told him it's probably a UFO and he should report it.
And traveled into the town of Roswell. He reported to the sheriff of Chavez County what he had found. Sheriff George Wilcox immediately notified the local airbase. Roswell Army Airfield was home to America's elite bomb group, the 509th. It was surrounded by the highest levels of security and secrecy. The 509th's Air Intelligence Officer was Major Jesse Marcel. He was assigned to investigate the material that Brazel had brought in. Marcel drove out to the Foster Ranch to collect some of the debris. That night he brought it back to his house to show to his wife and son.
He came back real late one night, about 2 o'clock in the morning, as I recall, very excited because he woke myself, my mother up, saying they found parts of a UFO or a flying saucer at that time, and he wanted me to see it because it was such an unusual type of finding.
Dr. Jesse Marcel Jr. is a state surgeon, pilot, and colonel in Montana's Air Force Reserve. In 1947, he was 12 years old, but he remembers the extraordinary nature of the material he saw that night in Roswell.
As I recall, the most unusual part of the debris that I saw was the I-beam fragments, or what I recall as being I-beam, because they were very light, very strong, and they had some writing along the inside surface of this. And that was a thing that really set this apart from anything I'd ever seen before.
Dan Dwyer and his colleagues in the Roswell Fire Brigade were also involved. The firemen were shown some remarkable material. Dwyer's daughter, Frankie, was in the station at the time and remembers picking it up.
When I wadded it up, it was like I had nothing in my hand. I couldn't feel it touching my skin. It was real weird. Drop it on the table and it's just like water, where it would spread out.
Meanwhile, Major Marcel brought the material he recovered back to Roswell Army Airfield, where the commanding officer, Colonel Butch Blanchard, surprisingly ordered his public information officer, First Lieutenant Walter Hout, to issue a shocking statement to the press.
I was instructed by Colonel Blanchard to put out a press release, which in effect stated that we had in our possession a flying saucer. In essence, it said that we have in our possession a flying disc. It was picked up on a ranch, and I can't remember if I said northwest of Roswell, brought into town by Mac Brazel, a ranch foreman, and the material was flown to higher headquarters, 8th Air Force, General Ramey.
Major Marcel had flown samples of the material to Fort Worth, Texas, headquarters of the 8th Air Force. Here, the story would take a remarkable new turn. General Roger Ramey, the commanding officer, called a press conference in his office. In front of photographers, he invited Major Marcel to display the material he had brought from Roswell. The base duty weather officer was also ordered to attend to explain to the press precisely what it was that Major Marcel was holding in his hands.
And the general called and said, get your ass over here to my office. We've got something here we want you to look at. And aye, sir. And he says, if you've got a car, fine. If you haven't, get one. Get the first means of transportation and get over to my office. And when I saw that, I said, is that your flying saucer? And they said, yeah. And I said, well, hell no. That's a Raven target and balloon. And if it is, I said, I'd eat it without salt or pepper. I know what that is. Are you sure? Yes, I'm sure. I know what that is.
This is what I would like to show you. In here, this is the photograph of the debris that was seen in General Ramey's office at Carswell Air Force Base in Fort Worth, Texas. This is my father holding up what is very obviously parts of a radar target with blown debris. In here, you see pulse wood fragments. You have actually parts of the balloon envelope in and of itself, and you have what looks like paperback metal foil. And to emphasize this is not what was seen on the floor of our kitchen that evening or that late, early morning hours in 1947. This is totally different.
The implication is that Major Marcel may have been ordered to take part in a cover-up that involves switching the material from Roswell for a weather balloon. General Ramey and the Air Force now discounted their earlier press announcements that they had found a flying saucer. The story was officially dead. But back in Roswell, those who had reported the original story found that the military was behaving strangely over what they now claim was merely a weather balloon. Frank Joyce had been the first to announce the original news on local radio station KGFL just a few hours earlier.
I got a phone call. Well, I got a number of phone calls, but the one that really got my attention was purportedly from the Pentagon. There was a young lady on the line saying, Colonel so-and-so, this is the Pentagon calling. And this was within a few minutes of it going out on the wire. And the voice on the line says, who is this? I tell him. He said, you put that story on the air about the flying saucer? And I mean, his voice was, you know, the type that really conveys menace and power. And I said, yes, I did. And he says, you're going to get in a lot of trouble for this, or made some threatening comment. And I said, look, I'm a civilian. You can't talk to me this way. You can't treat me this way. You can't tell me what to do in stories I put on the air. And he says, I'll show you what I can do. And bang, hung up the phone.
The voice at the other end of the line showed exactly what he could do.
I got a call from Washington from one of the officers of one of the senators saying, look, if you put out any stories on this thing, you're going to lose your license. It's not going to be over a period of time, it's going to be the same day that we tell you that you're off the air.
Frankie Rowe, the fireman's daughter who had handled some material, had always regarded the Army Air Force in Roswell as friends of the town. But an unexpected visit from the military to her home would prove terrifying.
He had this club, or stick, or whatever it was, and he was beating it on his hand. And he would hit it. Every time he would say something, he'd hit his hand. And he said, I want you to know you were never there. And I didn't understand what he meant. So I said, yes, I was. And he said, no, you weren't. I said, yes, I was. And he said, can't you get this through your head? You never saw anything. You were not there. You don't know anything. And he said, you know, this is a big desert out here. We can just take you out in the middle of this desert and no one will ever find your bodies. He said, you'll be nothing but bones and nobody will ever know what happened to you. And I told him I would not talk about it.
If it were not for the threats, the entire Roswell affair could be viewed as nothing more than an embarrassing mistake. But in 1965, Butch Blanchard, now a four-star general, attended a reunion dinner in Roswell, and the incident had not been forgotten.
He had been the commander here in 1947, and I was at a table with the general and several other locals when they were interrogating him about the 1947 incident, and he declined to answer any of the questions, except he did comment that it was the damnedest thing he'd ever seen.
He never would discuss it, but several months later, one night, I badgered him again, as I like to do, and he said, well, and he paused. He said, I'll tell you this, and I'm paraphrasing him because I don't remember exactly how he said it, but in essence, he said, what I saw, I've never seen before.
This program spans and military maintains an uneasy silence. The story didn't see the light of day until 1978, when Jesse Marcel, the 509's intelligence officer, went public with an appearance on television.
I was amazed at what I saw. My mind didn't believe it scattered over such an area. It took me a while to realize that there was something strange about it. But the more I saw the fragments, the more I realized that it wasn't anything that I was acquainted with. I proved by trying to burn it, it wouldn't burn. I tried to break it, it would not break. If it was something alive, I'm sure there would be no reason to keep it under cover that long. It's an aerial spacecraft. There's another reason why it would not have ever been owned by anybody here until they found out more about it. I sense that there was a cover-up someplace about this whole matter.
In 1947, General Raby's chief of staff was Colonel Thomas DeBose. Shortly before he died, he was interviewed on home video. As a retired brigadier general, he's the highest-ranking officer to comment on the Roswell incident.
Cover story. That we're willing to impress and that anything else just I mean, well, if you ever know that you want to work on the goddamn program, even every facet of the operation, he's a busy one. He wanted to know what the hell was going on. He was just on the cycle.
General McMullen, deputy head of Strategic Air Command at the Pentagon, was in charge of the entire operation, according to General DeBose.
McMullen told me, you are not to discuss this, and this is the point of...
Essence?
No, this is the...
More than top secret, as he said. Beyond that,
this is
it's
the
priorities.
Which she obviously has accepted to this one.
That's your Jewish?
Sit.
He's right.
See?
Sit, Papa.
Okay.
Sit, Papa.
Okay. I'm going to sit down and have my breakfast here on the final day of staying in your house until we come back again another day.
Sit on the couch.
And this is the day that we turn the clocks backwards because it's four back. And it's October. What? What's today's date? Anybody know? Today is the 29th of October. And we just changed our clocks today. Isn't that nice? I think so. Let's go to see what Bonnie looks like and Jessica, Steven.
I don't know. Look in there. Papa! Look in there. See it in there?
It's not an undershirt. I know what you thought it was, but it's okay.
Is that a onesie?
You got the back.
It is, but it's a turtleneck. It's a turtleneck! Well, I will leave this one.
I need this on.
You want this one on?
Yeah.
You do? Let me see. Look, turn around. Let's see what we got. What do we got?
It's wet.
My hair's wet. Is your hair wet? Your hair's wet too.
Yeah.
We got wet hair, two of us.
My hair is wet
together.
Too.
No, not your hair.
My hair is wet.
The Papa's wet. Papa's hair is wet.
Papa's hair is wet?
No. Don't.
Oh, is your hair wet? Yeah.
My hair is wet.
Grandma's hair is wet too.
No.
Yeah.
My grandma's hair.
Guess what? It's Halloween, the year 2000.
Yay, look at what they give it to you. Okay. Just one. Okay.
Bye.
It's too cold now.
It's too cold. Yeah. Oh, she's so pretty. What are you doing? Okay.
She started shy. It's shy a little bit.
Yeah. Cool. This is new.
Yeah.
This is new.
She's
going to
go home now.
You have a new siding put up. Nice.
Huh?
You have a new siding put up.
Yeah, they're falling apart.
Good for you.
Bye.
Bye. Happy Halloween.
Yeah. Bye-bye.
Thanks.
Happy Halloween! Happy Halloween!
Thank you.
How's my dog done? Happy Halloween!
Thank you.
Oops.
Thank you.
Thanks.
You guys, now
help! Uh-oh, you're the devil. Happy Halloween.
Oh, you're all on camera.
Thanks, that's not your house.
Yes, it is.
That's our house.
Thank you.
Happy Halloween. Whoa. You're on camera. Candid camera. Okay, happy Halloween! Well, at least the floor is not wet. Looking good. My kingdom, the floor ain't wet, and that's the biggest challenge. And now the news. You're looking at this year's almost do-it-yourself project, now in the rain, on hold for another sunny day. The estimated finish time, 2002. And it's only November 10th, 2001. Only 2 years to go. Good luck, neighbor at Plainview, New York. And in other news, what a rainstorm. Alan, come home and get your safe wet car. No, Alan, come home safe and get your wet car. Vehicle, that is. What a rainstorm. Good luck, pal.
Spectacular. Oh, you...
Oh, let's get this hat.
Oh, that's so great.
Hi, everybody. Steve.
Yeah, go look at Brad.
Omar.
Yeah, look at Brad.
How are you?
Oh, stupid.
Jessica.
Yes. Jessica.
How are you?
Well, she's the main person of the day. She's the main person. You want to take off your jacket?
Yeah.
Laura,
that's a nice
in?
Hat.
She's in the bathroom.
Oh, okay.
You're Minnie Mouse, aren't you?
Yeah, I'm Minnie Mouse.
Minnie Mouse.
She needs a cup of coffee.
Oh, sure. You want regular? Instant?
How are you?
The knee.
Mm-hmm. Look, mommy. Mommy, look. It's a horsey.
I know. I like the horsey.
Let me get out.
Where's your milk, Jess? Let me put it in the refrigerator. Come on, please.
How are you doing? Jess, what?
Wow.
Tell me your name. Jessica Faith Kantorowicz?
Yeah.
Oh.
Where do you live?
Where do you live?
What's your address?
We don't know address?
What?
Oh,
what?
Where do you live? Jess? Jessica? Where do you live?
Jessica?
Can I sit on the horse now?
I do that. What's your name, Jessica?
Can I sit on it?
Tell me your name.
How many horse?
Jessica, tell me your name. November 12th, the year 2000. And here goes Jessica playing with the games. What radio is that?
Hi, horse.
I want to see if that fuse is out.
You kidding?
I don't think it's the code, because I called my technician.
Yeah.
And he said the screen would go on and it would say code.
You killed
But how would I know where the fuse is, though?
Remember we glanced at it?
What do you got? What's that? You're
do
drinking
milk?
Nope.
You like
the
toast?
Okay.
Yeah, that's what I always get rid of, that's all.
Hi.
And she wants you to play with her.
We're looking at Stephen's fuse. He wants to have music when he drives his car. Isn't that correct? Am I not correct in assuming this is exactly what you want to have done?
Well, cookie.
I have something else.
What
do you want? Okay. I'll make a bunch for you.
Let me see.
And my favorite song is... The best of times is now.
Why don't you come look with me?
Pay for the perfume. So what did you accomplish in Stephen's car?
Don't believe John.
So?
But it's your situation.
Yeah, but it doesn't have to be. It's Sunday. I told Stephen he should bring something. I want him.
Yeah.
Huh?
He's happy with her.
I hope so.
She's a smart woman, right?
Mm. I don't know what the affairs.
Happy Thanksgiving in the year 2000.
Tell me.
I just don't know that one. Do you?
Did you see me do something?
And then there's Jessica.
Isn't that a small world?
How are you?
Hello.
Everybody, it's Thanksgiving 2000.
Yay! Thanksgiving
2000. Hey, Jessica.
Who is that?
She's pointing right into my lens. Nice to see you.
How you doing? How's the Nick?
Give me the phone.
I'll tell you that.
How do you figure that?
Yeah.
You're not talking? How come we're not talking?
But I gotta go. I'm getting an oil change. I'm getting an oil change. Car. Then I'm getting a new computer.
Those glasses are right.
Then I got the hot pog. And then I'm gonna go to the furniture store. If you want, I'll pick you up.
What is that thing that she's got, that light? Oh.
That's like a game. It does patterns and you're supposed to...
I sit on the chair.
Jessica!
I don't break these chairs.
Jamie's last words.
I don't. We actually sit at her table. There's this little winter pool table.
You know what? We'll get you a chair, put your name on.
Franks and egg rolls and spinach pasta. That's what I thought. And they only like the Frank
food. That's right.
So what am I buying all this other stuff for? So now I buy just the...
You're right.
Because when David, he says, what is this stuff? It was like a spicy...
You know what? If you have like new company, like you want to
don't
make,
know
it,
any better.
Make it look pretty, because it looks
they
nice.
They don't know any better.
Everybody
wants. Yeah, or they like the potato, but they don't like the other stuff. So I said, what am I... You only get 20.
What, like that Wilton stuff? That Wilton stuff?
That?
Like
it's
Wilton's,
yeah.
Wilton's, yeah.
You get 20
Frankfurt is. My son can be 20 Frankfurt is by himself.
Oh, so this is
120.
What is that?
Wicky sticks.
Yeah, well,
wax them.
What is that?
Wicky sticks?
Basically, they're pipe cleaners.
Walter, would you like to go to museums and all that with Alan?
A lot of stuff was totally beyond anyone's comprehension.
I wondered if you do it, he did it.
You were a science teacher, so.
Yeah, but still, that's...
Hey, just a perfect time. You don't have to watch the pregame.
But I like that music.
Yeah, it's great.
What?
It goes all the time.
Nice ones.
What?
No, I have a speakerphone.
Who called you at home for a cell phone business?
I have
your home number too?
I don't remember having any.
Thanksgiving is football, you didn't know that?
Headsets are good though, so they don't have I think we tried with
David. The hole was made in my door.
Like, it wasn't as clear.
I came up in the basement, was running around my whole house here. Got all the pictures on the floor.
I fixed his radio and his telephone don't work.
Better than the radio works.
No, it goes down the chimney by the flutes.
You gotta get him boat working.
Tuesday, I was sitting in and watching TV, and I saw something run from under the door. A big open house. That was not a bad house. That was bigger than a mouse. So I had a mouse. So I set the trap up. I think, well, whatever you like.
That's how windy you work. Wednesday, Thursday, the house is clean. Friday morning, I come down.
So what do you do? Lord was coming out and I was being
here for a home in 10 minutes, right?
And I see.
Depends on the client. I mean, like for this Deutschland thing, we'll, I'll probably do most of it. We have a lot of people to help us do this rollout. It's you. Last time we did it, consultants come in.
Well, happy Thanksgiving, everyone. The year 2000, and here we are in a long away places, far away places, and the next person you will see will be Jessica.
I have a new school picture of me. I should see you next time. Tommy, ready?
Yeah,
if you're going to eat those.
Ready? Yeah.
Jessica, you ready for turkey?
Yeah.
Today I ate breakfast. Oh, you didn't eat lunch? Did you know today's Thanksgiving?
What do you call it? I just ate like little appetizers.
She said, come to my house. Jessica. Macy's, you know,
she took the thing off. She wanted the scarf from the other Snoopy.
What? Oh, that's
cool.
Oh. Why can't I show the poor figure? What are you doing, Jess? Don't get stuck back there.
Yeah,
I know.
So cute.
That's a big Mickey
hat. So we're in Disney World.
Oh, he's sweet. He sings a song.
We make a big kiss on the nose. How many songs?
We had fun.
Just
one.
One.
We stayed at the in the place?
No, we stayed outside.
But then you have to take those shoes off. Here comes the closet. Come to the closet. Go slow, slow. You always have to go slow so you don't fall. Go slow. Don't
I
rush.
I found these shoes. I got to
okay, go on the carpet. It'll be easy. Whoa. I think they're meant for an old child.
Go slow.
She's
a
little
bit better.
She has a whole
bed.
She's finished.
Wait,
come back this way. Where are you going? Come back this
way. Is it good? Is it hard?
Yeah, it's hard.
Hold on to the wall.
Okay. Really?
Turn it around.
Are they staying there? He's not that close anymore.
Jessica.
No, I got to pay for the weekend.
Jess.
Very cute.
Never even invited me.
Jessica, go get the doggy book.
That would be a problem then.
Jessica, go get the
door. Jessica,
hi.
Jessica.
Hi.
Let's go eat dinner. Come on, let's take off the gloves and the shoes. We have to have our turkey. Okay. Well, they have. I don't go in your hat, but take your hat and get my cactus.
Hey. Up on the cutting room floor, I think.
In the archives.
They'll get some footage in about 20 years.
Yeah, they found those show tape.
That's right,
the
truth.
Wasn't any point where it was just like, oh, yeah.
Yeah.
I'm always getting rent.
She tried my grandma's chicken salad sandwich. My grandma pulls it out of her purse. I didn't need a chicken salad sandwich.
Yeah? Did you eat? You ate Uma's sandwich?
What's the matter? You couldn't give her the corned beef in there? You couldn't give her the corned beef? So always be prepared.
I want this sandwich.
What do you want?
Which one is? Don't tell me that you made her favorite.
What
did you drop? Mommy's getting you.
Wait,
you want
soup?
You want the soup in?
Hmm?
There you go.
What?
Did you want the soup?
Tell me what you want.
Soda.
Oh,
soda.
You don't want soda.
This?
She likes.
You like? Do you like
was
your popcorn?
I don't think she was scared with the monkey.
The monkeys are very scary. Excuse me. The monkeys they were talking about. I saw people talking. They're very scary.
You got a food on the plate.
And the witch says the monkey picked up
she
her dog.
Watched it.
Yeah, I was just saying.
She wasn't afraid.
Look.
Here. Do you want to have some?
Get on your plate. You would get that funny? You get your turkey.
Aww.
Put it on your plate. This is funny. You put it on your plate.
Look.
Like that. This is it. What color is this plate?
There's something different between her and Quintessa.
What color is
three
this?
Months younger. The nanny's daughter.
Yeah, I know.
The nanny's daughter stays with her grandmother, who doesn't really speak English.
Is this yellow?
And she basically grunts most of the time. Jessica is talking
sentences. Is this yellow?
She's very verbal.
Yeah.
This is a yellow plate.
It's like a tape recorder.
Is that a yellow plate?
No. Actually, I should.
No.
Oh, red. It's red. Is it red?
No.
What color is it?
What color is that?
Blue. Right.
Blue. That's
blue. And what color is... This is blue, too. What color is this? This is yellow.
Okay, have some more. Have some more turkey off your plate.
Yeah, you got two plates.
She doesn't want China. She wants Milma.
She like that. You can put in this one, too. Okay.
Okay.
Put it in there.
I'm gonna put the... Here, put
this... Put your turkey in there. Oh, that's funny. Look, green and yellow. It's pretty. Now eat it up.
Now take a piece. Eat it.
Eat it up. Chew it up good. Well, now eat it from the plate. Very good. Now take another one. Hurry up.
Last
I'm going to take one, too.
Il Vagabondo.
Did she see the parade on TV today?
A little bit.
And she wouldn't eat. And the only way she would eat is if the waiter came by, and we were putting it in her mouth to show it to the waiter. She liked showing off.
And
the waiter had to stay by the table for 10 minutes.
We give him a big tip.
You like the waiter?
I wonder who she takes after. Sorry,
That's what, you said he was a bad eater, right? Was Stephen a
Miss
bad
Showbiz.
Eater?
You don't know what bad eating is.
She's
are you kidding? Philip lived on Ritz crackers. Are you kidding?
He turned out okay.
He's and he's a good eater.
I didn't eat anything either, right?
We're taking Jessica on the road. And we're doing the show.
Hey, you were bad. You were older than that.
No, we're
but when you were little, you were not.
We were selling
it. New York City?
What? You don't eat everything.
Okay.
Pete, you don't eat grown-up food like you eat fish and stuff like that.
Take a piece.
Got one right now.
Yeah.
I'm sending $7.
When I ask her if she wants something right now, she says, what is she saying? No way.
No way.
No way.
Give me a $50 steak. Is that grown up?
Yeah. Put it in your mouth so then it won't be so big.
She prefers the dark meat too, doesn't she?
Yeah.
She's not dry. The dark meat is juicy.
Good.
Good job on the bone. I love it.
Mm-hmm.
So good.
How you doing, guys? I said to Jeff, he's at the med table. He throws his
jaw.
Stuffed. He's with the men.
They're seats. They sit at those seats every time. Mm-hmm. We all have assigned seats.
Yeah.
Well, because they do nothing except eat. That's why they sit there.
We do a job, we can take part.
That's where you sit. And when David is here, he sits there too. He don't do nothing except, oh.
See that, two bites.
I'm going to say
not
hungry. Okay.
Out of the kitchen.
What are they doing? You look at him. He makes as much as...
I have time.
Isn't it sad?
Yeah.
Like this singer? See this kid singing? Ooh, the fireworks!
Maybe you'll do that.
You want to sing at the football game, Jess?
You can tell, you want? You can sing the ABCs.
Star Spangled Banner. Oh, my son came back.
Blow out.
Second half.
Whoa!
Oh, yeah.
Good balance.
Oh, just getting tired. Nap time.
What do you say, Jess?
Thinking about something.
What's up?
Will you take ER for me tonight? ER, will you take it for me?
How do I do that?
Channel 4.
I'm not going home.
10 o'clock. No, 10 o'clock.
Okay.
10 o'clock, channel 4 for an hour, okay? You got that's daddy and mommy.
Daddy and mommy.
Hey, can I get an ice cream in too? That's a gun.
Where are you going?
Oh.
Yes.
he's worth like 2 billion.
Where are you going? Mouse looks like Minnie.
Not before 3.
I'd say 3:00.
Oh, then you're going to be there at 3:00?
I'd say 3:00.
What did you say we need for dinner?
I gotta go meet my friend to do something.
In the evening?
No, in the afternoon.
I'm gonna have dinner, Friday night dinner.
I can talk to Laura.
Okay, do whatever you think is good. And they're wonderful. Is that a good color? Where did we put, in here. Oh, I'm sorry. You'll take me tomorrow?
Certainly.
Don't do that.
Cook off the turkey a little.
You better tell Rob that you're not going to be here for dinner tomorrow.
I'll tell him. Don't worry.
Well, I'm going to be here.
Worry.
Otherwise, after dinner, you'll come here? Well, you have no place for us to sleep.
I know.
Because you got rid of all the beds.
I think I got a what bed?
You had a pull-out couch. And a bed in Stephen's room, and now there's no bed except for an Allen bed. Yeah, double bed.
Well,
you ever work out in my room?
Occasionally.
Why do you put that stuff downstairs?
I don't know. I just wanted to have a bed in the living room.
Not a bed. It's a job.
Doesn't matter. I mean, I have to be on. I have a Chicago show on Saturday. After.
I told you I don't kiss it. That's I kiss it in the eyes.
Big, work it out with him.
Not with this. Mom, what did you do?
I kissed that.
Oh, what happened?
Nothing. It's lipstick. Slipstick.
Wait a minute.
Whoa.
You're foaming at the mouth.
Are you foaming? Let me see. No, she's not foaming. She's burping.
Computer, email it.
If you don't call it
the whole thing's out.
That's the game.
Touch
they had a possible chance. Brand
the size of that boy.
His arms.
Really?
Happity, 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 ha. Happity, 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 ha.
Pick up your foot.
Oh, dirty.
Oh, God.
You're like in
dirty.
Yucky
feet.
Your feet.
Yuck.
It's what, like reshoeing a horse. Take up your foot.
Well, people are walking with shoes on.
Whoa. Oh.
The kitchen is the best thing I think
is under this carpet.
Decent
key. Mm-hmm. Right? I don't
like carpet.
It's
not
a carpet.
It's a
commercial carpet.
It's not
a
carpet.
I don't
like carpet.
Why?
You like
the
Louisiana tea? No, I don't.
You
never liked it? I like
well,
tell
me the
truth
now.
I like floors. I don't
like
floors.
Hello.
Hey.
Oh.
Do we have dessert?
Did you get hurt?
Tell the guys to come into dessert.
Ding, ding.
Desserts?
No.
No. You want Aunt Deli could give you a dessert.
She did.
She did. Maybe she eats for you. Nah, she's not. She, you know what? She did eat something.
No,
maybe
right
she eats
here
for you. Maybe she...
Can we show?
Yeah, was that 5 years ago?
My favorite show.
And then
your dad can take with me, right?
And until
my dad 2 years ago.
Right. So yeah. Fields,
I just eat that like old
right.
It's gonna be a cool one, I think. You
never have real plates.
Yeah, cool one.
Yeah. John has real plates.
We're at
wanna sing the hello song?
Why?
Oh yeah,
I've seen that.
They put some rice in there. They put a little.
Oh, you had. You mean instead of a plate, that's what you ate?
Yeah, that's what they served.
That's horrible.
It was easy to handle.
Yeah, that's cute.
What?
You went to momentum with these Syracuse.
You know how they have Chinese stuff on the
street? I gotta make
some room. They started in like the little one of the early ones they ever had people coming and saying,
so,
where was the mother's from?
Hello.
Hello. Two mommies.
Oh, me and me.
No?
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 Okay.
No. Right.
Well, that's when you were having. Right. No, right. Where are the boys from, Mr.?
Stay quiet.
Whoa.
No, so I was playing.
She was like, don't get racist. Right. Wedding was.
I was playing
very
for
nice,
the,
Mr.
I don't know, the mom
very fancy.
One
CD with all these artists
I've already
before they did the Helmut Blues.
The boys' moments was in Temple Bay.
We were at a wedding.
We had our own day.
Very good. Very beautiful.
When's that? The 13 already?
They had just come back from the honeymoon. So they didn't go to Dara's wedding.
And we had a wedding.
And you had a wedding. That's right, Delphine's wedding.
But that place has been redone very recently.
Stephen, are you going to clear it in?
Yes, if I
very
can get her off my knee.
Whoa!
They gave us a great deal.
Come on, just
you're
dirty.
Sunday afternoon.
So. Co is nice, but this
they
is
came
nice.
Back to us.
It is.
The,
it's nice.
No,
it's
nice.
A better price.
No, not that it was a better price, but
it's not. It is
there,
nicer.
It's
nicer. Newer.
Temple.
It's beautiful.
Temple
Bell
Tower.
Well, our friend's son was married there. The son this year, in July, the Sunday night of July 4th weekend.
I think they also
conservative.
It's different.
Can I hold you? Can I hold you? Come
on,
can you come?
Yeah. Oh, a lot of us did.
Yeah,
we ran like crazy. We got your date.
Nah.
You know why? Because
she burst the bubble.
Spider went up the water spout. Down
came the rain and washed the spider.
She's a scary table.
She looks at them and she looks out.
I'm looking over there.
You know what? They're innocent. You know who that is? That's Cousin Phil. See, Cousin Phil, raise your hand. That's Cousin Phil. Wait, look this way.
Zero interest.
Raise your hand again.
Hi.
Hi.
Cousin
Andy, raise your hand. Cousin Andy, look, he raised his hand.
Why
is he Jeff?
But I see a lot of Jeff.
Jeff is over there.
My father says that when he holds her, he says it's like looking at me all over again.
No, Roz was
the
most beautiful. Roz was the most beautiful baby. People stopped in the street. No baby has ever been as beautiful as Marcy.
Who says that?
Grandpa.
Is that what he said? You feel bad?
She was the most beautiful.
You're mad at him, not me. I never said it.
I got the personality, but she got the looks. What can
I tell you?
She was very
I think Jessica looks just like Roz.
So what was it?
Well,
good. As your grandma used to say,
in this family we don't make monkeys. In this government, in this family, are monkeys.
This can make
she
monkeys.
Said,
this family did no monkeys.
All the babies in our family were beautiful. They didn't all stay.
No, most of them.
But they were. Every baby was outrageously beautiful. Debbie.
Yeah, my cousins were they were very pretty children.
All of them.
they grew up and
Amy was beautiful. They were all cute.
Well, some of them changed. Some of them didn't. Some
but
of them
they
stayed
were
pretty.
Very cute.
Some
babies.
Of them were pretty. Janice and Marsha stayed pretty.
They're cute.
They were cute. They were nice. Yeah. you and I, we know we stayed pretty, so that was it.
Jessica.
Yeah, we're the better looking people.
Jessica. Uncle Alan is saying hello to you.
That's not even saying anything. It's just a fact.
Well, we looked at pictures last week.
My cousins, my sister and I are definitely better looking.
This is Bo Peep.
That's in our backyard.
That's our backyard.
Yes.
The little red car.
Well, this is Bo Peep.
Birthday and Uncle Sam took him shopping and they come home with this car. What is this?
Yeah, how did he not kill us?
Jesus Christ.
I tried many times.
Absolutely no safety precautions.
Yeah, no. Maybe that's why we're not scared.
Wild.
There is no safety.
That's why we're not scared.
You have to look around, throw you all over the place.
Safety?
Grandma used to say there was something wrong with you guys because you never cried when you were hurt. Yeah. You'd be bleeding all over the place.
Internalized.
And they say something.
I'm like, yes.
And you used to talk about Dana. You'd say, why is she crying? That's what maybe she has a boo-boo. But why is she crying?
I guess.
No.
Have a happy Thanksgiving.
God bless.
We had those little price cards. We had two of them, of course.
Let me say goodbye to the baby.
Goodbye,
darling.
Goodbye.
Bye, Steve.
Bye. See you tomorrow.
Goodbye.
Bye, Jessica. Kiss.
Goodbye,
bye-bye.
Jessica.
Kiss. Bye-bye. Mwah. I love you.
Goodbye, Jessica.
I've never been there. I've heard of it.
I'll see you soon.
I'll see you soon.
I wouldn't drive in the city.
Mom,
and they said, no, just, you know.
The year 2001. Today is 6:10. I mean, the time is 6:10 p.m. It's 1:20, the year 2001, inauguration day of President Bush. W, that is, Bush. Let's see what he could do. Slickness out here.
Some sand.
Get some sand. We gotta put some sand.
New car. Steven's new car. It's a Honda, which I'm fond of. 2001. All right. Lovely car, Steven.
Nice car, huh?
Good luck and mazel tov. Girl, you like your new car? Your daddy's new car. Your mommy's new car. You like that? Yeah?
Like our new car?
Yeah, this is for you.
This is stuff from the old car.
You can use this. For now. Unless I need it eventually. I have this.
No.
Do me a favor.
Lori.
What?
Mazel tov.
Thank you.
It's a very, very nice car.
This is the CD. I think for the 12 CD.
Right.
But when my technician took it all out, hold on, actually maybe is it out now? Oh, now it's out. Okay, I got it out.
Good, so those are the CDs.
Yeah, I got to pick CDs in.
Gesundheit! Gesundheit! Why are you crying?
What?
Rugrat.
Everybody wants to feel that.
for me, baby.
Thank you so much for offering us your home. Family?
Napoleon, that sounds like the end.
Wait a minute, I'm the leader. I'll say when it's the end. It's the end.
Can you find a little ball? Can you throw a 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 ball?
Stamp your feet before you walk anywhere. Stamp your feet. Stamp your feet. Grandma.
Yeah.
Get.
What are you doing there? You're so busy.
Then you gotta go to the right doctor. Don't you, Dad? You're gonna just complain about it. You gotta.
Those big, big lawns.
I don't know. What do you mean by well done?
It would be very tough to have a big lawn and be my
medium.
And be my age.
What?
That's why people drop these houses like hotcakes. Houses. They go to apartments.
You have to just hire a company.
Come on, Jess. Let's go to bed.
But it's not as easy as you think, everybody.
Up.
10 minutes.
This don't match with that. Hello? Hold on, please. Right now.
We ain't never seen this much snow since 1928 out here. And it's still snowing. And this is this is the year 2001, March, almost my birthday, the 25th. Non-stop snow.